In this video, I want to talk about the ascending and descending somatosensory pathways. In other words, how does somatosensory information that enters the spinal cord get to the brain, and how can we modulate it? Well, let's begin by looking at the pathway used by touch receptors. Just to orient you, what we're looking at here are three sections through the central nervous system. Here's a section through a lumbar segment of the spinal cord, a cervical segment of the spinal cord, and here's a segment through the medulla. And what I want you to remember is that touch receptors, such as the Spinal corpuscle, enter the dorsal horn, and then that axon turns and enters the dorsal column. Now I'm adding a touch receptor that's coming higher, say from your arms. Well, this also enters the dorsal horn of its spinal segment, and it will enter the dorsal column. But remember that the body is mapped in the dorsal column, so that input from lower in the body travels closer to the midline, while input from the upper limbs travels closer to the gray matter, more distally. No matter the level at which the touch receptors enter this spinal pathway, they travel through what's called the dorsal column, and they'll travel all the way to the medulla, where they'll make synapses onto cells. Second-order cells in these nuclei in the medulla will then project to the thalamus. The track that travels from the medulla to the thalamus is called the medial lemniscus, and this explains why overall the pathway is called the dorsal column medial lemniscal pathway. And remember, this is where we're going to process information about touch, as well as a lot of information about conscious proprioception. Let me make a couple of points. First, I want to introduce some terminology. When we're talking about the neurons in a pathway, we'll talk about first order, second order, third order neurons. The first order neuron is the start of the pathway. Here it's the sensory neuron. The primary neuron is the sensory neuron. Now, in this case, the information from the right side of the body is entering the right spinal cord, so we say that it's ipsilateral. Ipsi means same, so this is just telling us that the receptors are traveling through the spinal cord in the same side that they entered in. Now, the second order neurons will pass over and cross to the contralateral side. And from this point on, information about the right side of the body will be processed by the left side of the brain, and vice versa. All right, I want to talk a little bit about where information goes from the thalamus, so let me make a bit more room. And now let me bring in a picture that shows us the thalamus. The somatosensory information synapses on a specific region in the thalamus called the ventral posterior lateral nucleus. Here, there are third-order neurons that will project up to the somatosensory cortex. I also want you to notice that the spatial organization that was established when the neurons entered the spinal cord is preserved in the medulla, in the projections to the thalamus, and ultimately at the level of the somatosensory cortex. You probably remember that in the somatosensory cortex there's a topographical map where lower structures lie close to the midline and more rostral structures like your arms and your face lie more laterally. Now let's turn to a second pathway. This is the pathway that will be used by the receptors that are sensitive to pain and temperature. So just as a reminder, remember that we've got two classes of these receptors, the A delta that are a little bit bigger and lightly myelinated, and then the C fibers, which are thinner and unmyelinated. Both of these have their cell bodies in the dorsal root ganglion, and then they make synapses onto cells in the dorsal horn where they terminate. So let's look at the second order neuron. So here what you can see is that the second order neuron has a cell body that lies in the dorsal horn. It crosses the midline at the level of the spinal cord, and then it will ascend all the way to the thalamus. That's true for the A delta fibers. It's also true for the C fibers. There is one important distinction though. Whereas pretty much all of the A-delta fibers make their way up to the thalamus, only about 15% of the projection neurons that get input from the C fibers get that far. The other 85% sends off these collateral branches that make widespread projections through the brainstem. Some of the regions that get innervated are the superior colliculus of the midbrain, the periaqueductal gray matter, parabrachial nucleus of the pons, the reticular formation. Some of these neurons then send projections to part of the cortex that are distinct from the somatosensory cortex. We'll come back to that a little bit later. For now, what I want to stress is that in the spinal cord, these projection neurons are traveling through what's called the anterolateral tract. And because a lot of this information is traveling up to the thalamus, we call this the spinothalamic pathway. So this is how we're going to get information about pain and temperature into our brain. Let's think about the neurons in this chain. The first neuron, the sensory neuron, is ipsilateral. But the second neuron here will cross to the contralateral side. So even though the cell body lies in the ipsilateral dorsal spinal cord, it immediately crosses over. Once this happens, information from the right side of the body will be processed by the left side of the central nervous system and vice versa. Okay, let's look what happens after the information makes it to the thalamus. The good news here is it's essentially the same. And just like with the touch receptors, the somatotopic organization is preserved in the thalamus and then in the somatosensory cortex. Well, the two pathways that I've told you about so far have both been ascending pathways. They've been ways to carry information from the periphery up to the spinal cord. But there are also many, many descending pathways, and I want to talk about one of them that modulates pain information. So let's orient you. Here again, just to remind you, our pain receptors are entering the dorsal horn, making synapses onto second-order neurons, and those are traveling up to the brain. And then there's this widespread projections that go to a lot of different brain regions. One of the things that happens with these widespread projections is that they can actually activate feedback loops that can either lessen the propagation of painful information or enhance it. They carry out this action through descending pain pathways. Let's look at one. So here we're looking at a series of sections through the brain. This will be a frontal section through the cerebrum. Here's a section through the midbrain. This is a section through the level of the pons, and down here is the spinal cord. A number of different regions can feed into this descending pathway. They include parts of the cortex. So the anterior cingulate cortex and the insular cortex are both involved in our emotional perception of pain. Another part that feeds into these descending pathways is the amygdala, which we associate with fear, and the hypothalamus, which is involved in visceral reactions, is also involved. All of these pathways can send projections down to the brainstem where they can make synapses. In the midbrain, one particularly important target is the periaqueductal gray matter. This is what it sounds like. It's a bunch of cell bodies that are lying around the aqueduct that connects the third ventricle to the fourth ventricle. The neurons in the periaqueductal gray area project to a number of regions lower in the brainstem. Among these are the raphe nuclei. You may remember that that's that ridge of nuclei that lies all the way along the length of the brainstem. And these have a high concentration of serotonergic neurons. These can be activated directly by cells in the periaqueductal gray matter, as well as by indirect input from one of the other nuclei in the pons. Either way, the serotonergic neurons can send their axons down the spinal cord, where they can release serotonin in the dorsal horn. Another nucleus in the pons also sends its axons down to the same region of the spinal cord, where it releases norepinephrine. And so we can have modulatory effects of both serotonin and noradrenaline acting on the pain pathways. Let's look at some of the mechanisms involved in this modulation. We now know that the population of pain receptors isn't homogeneous, but a large number of C fibers, though, about half of them, fit this profile, where they secrete both glutamate and a peptide transmitter called substance P, and these will activate the projection neurons, sending the information into that spinothalamic pathway. In addition to the sensory neuron and the projection interneuron, there are also local interneurons, and some of these local interneurons make axo-axonic synapses onto the terminals of the sensory neurons. And here they can release GABA and enkephalin. So GABA is a small inhibitory neurotransmitter, and enkephalin is a small peptide neurotransmitter. Both of them act to inhibit neurotransmitter release. The descending serotonergic neurons from the raphe nuclei will release serotonin, activating this inhibitory interneuron, which then inhibits the release of neurotransmitter, so less pain is traveling to the brain. Descending noradrenergic neurons from the pons can also make synapses. Some of these do this directly onto the projection interneurons, where they can release norepinephrine and have an inhibitory effect. Either way, the projection interneurons are less likely to fire action potentials, and so the brain will perceive less pain. Let me close with one last piece of information. This molecule here, enkephalin, this is what's called an endogenous opioid. So this is a natural transmitter that our own bodies produce, and it binds to its receptors. But the receptors that enkephalin binds to in order to inhibit pain are also targeted by opioids such as morphine. Spinal analgesics can exert their effects by working on this system.